Okay, I'm right off on my back porch. Okay, as you know, for the last three years actually, I would say, and the evening, the sun set right over there. If you look on earlier videos, you'll see that. Why is the sun sitting way over there in southeast? It's October 18th, 2016. It's 6:05 p.m. Now the sun is setting what would be called east-southeast right now. Right there. Okay, east-southeast. Up until about a year and a half ago, I'd say about a year ago, really, the sun would come up directly across from us east. It was set directly west, right where you see that yellow for the sky, orange is yellow, that's where the sun would come down. So what happened? Why all of a sudden is the sun not setting in the west like that, like it's normal, but in fact in east-southeast right now? Okay, I've got tomatoes that are growing out here. I let them go. It's going to get cool Thursday, Friday, Saturday. I mean, after tomorrow. Tomorrow's supposed to get in the low 80s, I believe. We cut down all the okra except for two plants here in the number one garden. I'm cutting off pieces of them and giving them the PD, and I've had one or two off the vine, off the stem, whatever you want to call it. But, and then there's like one, two, three, four, five in the back of the garden back there. You can see them all along the back. But the wind blew this over. We didn't touch it, and we're letting it just keep growing like this and blow it over. The tomatoes out here, I've taken them. I had them all bunched up inside these baskets, which is a mistake. I'm not going to do that anymore. John Kensel was telling me that he doesn't use baskets, or he does, but I don't know his exact situation. But I had mine all constricted. I took them out, and look at how they're all green. They're all seemingly healthy. I've got tomatoes all over. Look at this one here in the basket with my chard. I've got that big green one, that little one right there just starting about a week ago. See, this is chard, Swiss chard. I got one, two Swiss chard in here. No, three actually. Look at this, like two seeds side by side there. And then this one here. Two there too, actually, there's four. But, then over here I've got kale. I just pulled one plant out because there's three in here. Now there were four. And that's just too many for a 5-gallon bucket. Two is about what you'd want, if that. One is all you really should have. But I was eating some of the leaves off the other one because it was all down off, but there was some fresh in the center like this, nice deep. It's real bitter like this too. But this has got the most vitamin K you'll ever get. You want to get some vitamin K from this. Kale and chard. And I just put that branch of that tomato over there, which, because that was getting heavy. I took them out, like I said, I took them out of the baskets. I'm letting them stay in the center. I can't pull them out all the way. Because the way the branches are. So I've been letting them come out freer. This one here, you see that tomato down there? One down there on the ground. Where those leaves are at. There. Yeah, nice size one right there. It's about the size of a baseball. That one right there, about the size of a baseball. There's a small one right up there. I don't know if you can see that one. Alright. I see it's focusing on the branches before it. But there's one over there. And then in the back here, that's my pear tomato. I picked it off yesterday. It's ripening up in the house. It was just, look how the branches, because of the disease. I've been peeling the branches off like crazy. But then look at how healthy they're coming back now. Look at this, after I pulled off all the diseased branches, okay, stems, whatever. Yeah, see like how you got the two right there. That one's not gonna make it, I know that right now, it's too small. Those two might get two of those, one down there. See there's one right down in there. I don't know if I can see on the viewfinder here. Right in the center there. Actually, let's go around over here. Right there. That's a big one too. So there's about eight of these that should be able to be picked here in about another week. I don't remember leaving this out here, but I did. See that other tomato plant on this side? See, there's a bunch of little ones like this. That one right there, that little green tomato. Right there. Where was that one? It was on the ground, I thought. Anyway, you can see how thick they are and how healthy they look. I'm still pulling off these dead branches. Like, see, like this here. I can't do it with the camera. But like this here, I'm breaking this all off. This is, I'm going to try to cut this off like that. See that? This is all dead branch, all dead leaves and stuff. So I'm breaking these off away from the fresh green stuff. And like I say, you see how this is all growing back here now. There's the one. The one down there. One over there. I showed these on the other side. There's one down on the ground somewhere too, I know. I can't move these branches around. There's so many. Like I said, now they're on the ground, everything. There's one down there. Well, that's the one I showed. But and then using these tomato cages in fresh areas just to push them into the plastic in the ground, try and put branches through them to use them to set up like this here. See, this one was one I put in the ground here and put branches through it because it's got weight for the tomato here. See this branch here, this little branch, stem, whatever. So just break it off. I can't do it with the camera good. I can break them off, but it's not easy. I'm not doing a good job. But like tomorrow, I'll come out here and get those leaves down there. Down there, some more dried up leaves. And, you know, like I say, it's only got about, let's see, September. I mean, October. I'd say about the second week of September. I might have to stop there and tear everything up. There's a tomato right down there, too. Let me see that one. Right there. Anyway, quite a few tomatoes out here yet. I hate tearing up anything before it absolutely has to come up. So the tomatoes are putting out now should have about 2, 4, 6, 8. I'd say about 10 tomatoes, good sized tomatoes. You know, we pulled one off in the house yesterday that was so. It was the one that was out here for so long. It turned early. My wife finally just picked it yesterday and it looks like it's okay. These are heirlooms, so it's a different looking tomato. They're not the bright red ones that are genetically modified or engineered to be a perfect red little round tomato and all that. So that's why fried green tomatoes, that makes me wonder, this might be good, but I'm gonna let it stay out here for about a week or two yet. I'll try getting these leaves, these dead leaves off them tomorrow without the camera. My beans are almost all, my peas are almost all done picked. They've been picked over so much. You know, like I said, we didn't do a good job on that either this year. Every year we do something different. We don't really follow through each time all the time. But next year, the peas and beans are going to go over here. We're going to cut the plastic so that there's a walkway in between here. It won't be as wide as this one. But we'll cut the plastic here and here. So we'll have four gardens. Okra will go back over in there. We'll have about 10 okra, at least 10 okra. And I'll get 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and then 2 rows at least. That's 10. That's more than enough. We might do a few more. So, taking the plastic off here, and the plastic's going to stay off. My wife wants to put tomatoes and peppers here, which, I mean, my point is tomatoes need heat. The plastic helps with heat. So we might maybe put a couple of tomatoes over here too. Because this is the one that gets the most sun. It's all back here. Because the way the hills are in the shade and everything. Full sun is over here most 80% of the day right here. Over here is the last one to get the full sun. This one gets it. This one comes here. It comes this way. It gets this. And then as this one gets it, then this one gets it. So I'm going 20 feet off the outside of the plastic over there. Up back. And this to the back row back there where the high grass is for the other yard or field where the Monsanto is. That's 20 feet back from the plastic. The little bushes right there you see was the original yew I had around the garden. I had sunflowers, different types. Those torch ones there and the yellow sunflowers right where those are at. But they're going to go back another, I think it's about 10 feet back, yeah, 15 feet. So it's 20 feet off the plastic. And then the same thing over this way, we're going to go 20 feet off the plastic. So it'll be a giant yew, raking the leaves on top of them, top of that yew, and we're going to burn pieces at a time because it's out here in the open. You can't burn them all because it will start a forest fire. But I have to use a rake. It's going to be a lot of work. And of course, I'm going to be hurting and painful, in pain. But I have to rake all these leaves, kind of like on an outer area over there. We're going to put some tomato stakes over there. Zoom in. Tomato stake there and a tomato stake over here is about the width of the tiller. And then come out here and do the same thing. And then till it. And then around the back, just do one tomato stake out, because I know how far back it is over there. And go all the way across the back. And then two tomato stakes there. All the way up to over there, two tomato stakes. And then we'll have our big U. And the leaves are going to be raked up right till almost the edge there. And after it's done that, then I rake the leaves on top of the bare dirt. So it'll be, just as an imagination, this walkway here is wider than what that's going to be. But just imagine this with leaves on it. Then after I till it, I mean, it'll be tilled, then I'll put the leaves on top here, then we'll burn about a 10-foot section at a time, another 10-foot section, and keep doing it like that, and then we'll till that into the ground all the way around the garden, and that'll make it really good fertilizer for the winter. And take this plastic up here. I don't know if we're going to take the plastic up right now, or if we'll do that in the spring. I think we should wait till spring, because that'll keep the ground kind of warm. So when the spring comes, the ground will already have a little bit of a head start. So I'm going to tell my wife, or, you know, suggest to her that we leave the plastic on here until spring. I'm talking about, you know, February, March. Because we're going to plant our garlic out here. We have to dig up an area for that now. So might have to do a separate section just for that garlic. We'll put about, I'm going to put out 10 cloves of garlic out here. And we'll get some good bulbs, man. I mean, we get some that are almost the size of a baseball, I swear, our garlic heads from Heirloom Solutions. So I'm telling you, you want some fresh vegetables, some heirloom vegetables, heirloomsolutions.com is the place I go. I mean, but anyway, that's just what I'm talking about with the tomatoes, how the tomatoes are healthier now in September, I mean, late October, than they have been all year. And like I said, I've been taking them, pulling them out of the cage and busting off, breaking off all the dead leaves and all that that are on them. And you see all the tomatoes on it now. Now that there's a few butterflies around here. The hummers are gone. Yesterday, or day before yesterday, was the last time we had one of our hummers. Been keeping the feeder out there. There's only one out there. Tomorrow we're going to take it down. But the torch sunflower is there, over there, and right here. What keeps up the butterflies, and if we do have any other, you know, like a hummer or bees. There are some bees that are just laying on the flowers as if they're dead or something. Oh, there's one over there too, the torch. See, the torch is going to be mixed in with the regular yellow sunflowers in the big U around the garden too. And that should be really, I mean, last year it was pretty decent. It was spread out quite a bit. And I blame the Monsanto with all this cotton that's been around. This is the most toxic sprayed shit that there is on the planet. And it was right around here, and all the sunflowers seem to be dying after that. So they'll get planted about the third week in March, because it takes about a month for them to come up, March, April. And then by May, the sunflowers should be up, you know, about as tall as that first okra plant right there. And by July into August, it'll be like that one there, about 6 foot tall. Well, that okra back there is about 7 foot tall, that last stem right there. So, I don't know if I can just see, there's no bees out here. The other day there was about two or three bumblebees, or honeybees actually, on each flower. Now there's none down here. Over by the porch, I pulled up half of the plant because the wind blew it over. No matter what we did, we tried stakes and everything else to keep it up, but it just kept falling over. So, but there was like two or three honeybees on each one of those flowers, which this is really good for honeybees. The torch sunflower is a really good sunflower for honeybees. Large wing butterflies, it attracts monarch butterflies when they're doing their little seasonal migration, and hummingbirds. I mean, they all go to that. So these are really good flowers to have around the garden. And plus it helps, you know, that helps draw it to the okra with the flowers they have and such too. So anyway, whew, the toxic cotton is gone. The toxic poisons have been watered into the ground. Our groundwater is almost certainly polluted. God. All right. It's about 6:15 now. 6:20. So 6:20 p.m. It's October 18th, 2016.